All right, I'd like to call for order the regular meeting of the Board of Directors of the Joshua Basin Water District for Wednesday, February 1st, 2017. And please rise, and Miguel, you want to lead the Pledge of Allegiance? No.
Pledge allegiance.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Item three, termination of quorum.
Let's see, Director Unger, present. Director Johnson.
Here.
Director Luckman.
Here.
Director Fuller.
Here.
Director Hund is not here, he's en route from another meeting. You have a quorum.
Hey, item number four, oh, he's en route, he is here, all right. Welcome, Gary.
Thank you.
Item number four, approval of the agenda.
Yes, Madam President, I'd like to make some recommendations for a change that we table number nine. And we move number eight to 15A.
And the reason for that change is that we have received a bid, but it came in today at 4 o'clock from Tri-County and Law 14. We've not had enough time to analyze it. So once we get it analyzed, we'll be ready to bring it to the board. It might be a special meeting or it might be the February 15th meeting, just depending on.
So what is it, Paul?
We're going to table number nine and move number eight to 15A.
So the closed session will be at the end of the meeting instead of in the middle. Okay, with that, do I have a motion? Are you moved to, do I have a second?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Carries. Item number five, public comment. Is there going to be any before I read this? Seeing none, we will not read the whole background of it. The consent calendar. Items on the consent calendar are considered routine in nature and will be adopted in total by one action of the Board of Directors, and if any board member or any individual or organization interested in one or more consent calendar items wishes to be heard. It includes draft minutes of the January 18th, 2017 regular meeting of the Board of Directors and the check registers October through December 2016, which was approved by the Finance Committee on January 23rd. Do I have a motion?
I move we adopt the consent calendar.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed? Stands. All right, we will move to item number seven. Update by the Bureau of Reclamation concerning pilot studies for the treatment of chromium 6. Miguel, and I'm not going to try and pronounce your last name, although I'm sure it's relatively easy. Yeah.
So, Madam President, if I may, it's with a great deal of pleasure that Miguel is back to report to us on the findings that the Bureau of Reclamation has been doing on chromium 6 treatment, anion exchange, and I think he's also going to cover stannous chloride. Again, this is a study that's primarily funded by the Bureau of Reclamation with assistance from the Mojave Water Agency and, of course, some of our staff time and things like that. But primarily, it's a study that's been driven by the Bureau of Reclamation, and I hope that Miguel takes a little bit of time to talk about the staff of what now five, I think it is, a year and a half ago, maybe a little longer when we first started. Miguel was the only one addressing this issue, and the Bureau of Reclamation has now expanded that program to include other states and several other sites. So I hope he takes a little bit of time to talk about that as well. And it's a pleasure working with you and your staff, and there you go.
What a great introduction. Thank you so much. So just to give you a little bit of background, I came here about a year and a half ago with my hat in my hand. And, you know, really, I got into water many years ago because I liked helping people. My mom, actually, I was just recounting the story, talked me out of being a doctor. She said, you'll help more people treating water than I'll never see you. Wow. And she was right. You know? So I came here hat in my hand, you know, a year and a half ago, and What started as a fairly small project is actually one of our largest research projects now. It's currently expanded to another site in Oklahoma, which is actually a reclamation site. But if they were to lose their ability to, if chrome were to be regulated, they would lose the ability of 30% of their water supply. So it'd be a huge impact for them. So we're currently testing there. We're testing here, and a lot of exterior consultants have actually come to us as technical experts in the field. So there's been several companies that have approached us to work with us in terms of consulting firms, in addition to companies that are vendors for ion exchange plants, so the guys that actually are the boots on the ground that will install your plant. And it's been really exciting for us. A lot of people that are named there have learned a lot, and we've, you know, come a long way from a year and a half ago. So with this, you know, I want to introduce you guys to the treatment processes we've been doing here for the past year and a half. My name is Miguel Arias-Peich. I'm half Chilean, half Croatian, but I've been in here a long, you know, I've been in the U.S. a long time. So I'm 41, so some people were thinking I was started school when I was 12. It's actually not true. It's not true. Of this team, four of them are PhDs, and they're a stellar group to work with, really on top of it. Some people read Chrome stuff for fun, you know, on the weekend. So you guys have an amazing brain trust working on this. I just want to point that out. So with that, let's go to the next slide.
Control if there are going to do it here.
Oh.
This one right there.
So just to give you a little background about hexavalent chrome, we're going to look at the occurrence of what's called hexavalent chromium. So it's chrome 6. It has several names. It's typically in the chromate form. So I know Kurt was saying there's a lot of chromes. Anyway, hexavalent chromate is the one that we're worried about. We'll talk about the treatment technologies for chrome 6 removal, some pilot ion exchange operation, and some stannous chloride pilot ion, pilot operations. So to give you a little background on chromium, it's naturally occurring, and it's found in groundwaters. There's two forms. There's a chrome 3, it's non-toxic, and there's a chrome 6, which is toxic. So the chrome 3 is actually your supplement, your chromium picolinate, something you can buy off the shelf. So you can go to the supermarket, find it, and ingest it, right? EPA currently regulates total chromium at 100 microgram per liter in drinking water. However, California, you know, in 2014, started regulating chrome 6 at 10 microgram per liter in the drinking water. So there's many utilities that meet the EPA regulations, but not the California ones, and many other states are thinking about potential national regulations. So if you squint really hard, you can see that chromium is actually fairly common in groundwater. There's a lot of sites that are greater than 20 microgram per liter. And it's funny, the site that we're working at is in Oklahoma. And you can see that there's one dot in Oklahoma. And it's actually the highest occurrence in all of the U.S. So it's at least double what you guys have here, if not almost 10 times for some of the wells. So anyway, you guys know where you're at in California. And you can see that it mainly affects groundwater systems, similar to what Joshua Basin has, where multiple wells are feeding a distribution system, and it occurs in all the wells. So one of the hard things is it's difficult to have a centralized treatment unit. So you can say, hey, we've identified these ways of treating it, but it's at all these remote wells. So it's not that simple to go, okay, we're going to install treatment at each well. You want to make this economical, right? It's clearly easier to have one plant, one location. Here it's not feasible. So it's estimated that over 600 entry points in California alone have chrome greater than 10 microgram per liter. So there's several technologies capable of removing chromium. There's strong base ion exchange, there's weak base ion exchange, and reduction coagulation filtration, which is essentially the stannous chloride some people have heard about in the room. I won't really talk about the weak base because economically there were two groups maybe 10 years ago that thought either weak base or strong base would be the better technology. and it seems that Strong Base now is more or less the clear winner in terms of that's a technology you'd rather apply. So to talk a little bit about your raw water quality, there's a lot of numbers on there, a lot of constituents, chloride, sulfate, nitrate, your total chrome, and this is at one of the particular wells here. And really, what I want to say is, I drink this water. There's no doubt about it. I mean, what's in here, to me, constitutes a great water. Is the chromium above what the California standard is? Absolutely. But you know, a barometer for me is, wherever I go, if I drink the water, generally I think it's pretty good. So I think you guys actually have great water quality. Obviously, there's a regulation that's there in place. So it is above that. So a lot of people have asked me, well, what do the resins look like? You know, on the left is actually the ion exchange resin. And they're little tiny beads. So if you look at them, they're almost perfect spheres, if you look at each one, if you were to zoom in on it. And the way that it treats your water is raw water with sulfate and chromate coming into the system. So chromate is chrome 6, Kurt, just to clear it up one more time. Your raw water comes in, and the sites on the resin, so if you actually look at the resin bead, if you have a pointer here.
Yeah, it ain't gonna.
It's not going to happen.
No.
Okay.
We can bring you in like this, though.
Okay. So if you look at the resin bead, what happens with the resin is that when it's freshly regenerated, all the sites on the resin are occupied by chloride. Okay. And as sulfate and chromate start coming in contact with the resin, they start getting removed. And your treated water, after a while, you'll see it'll start to release sulfate. So why does it have such a high affinity for the chromate? Because if I look at my concentrations of sulfate to chromate, I actually have 216 times more for this particular well sulfate than I do chromate. So the way to answer that question is actually by looking at selectivity. So the really beautiful thing about ion exchange is that if you look at this table, and this is on a relative affinity, you know, if chloride has an affinity of 1 for the resin, you can see that sulfate is 9 times more apt to attach to the resin. Chromate is actually 100 times more, and uranium is 3,200 times more. So the certain things that you have in your water, you actually have a trace amount of uranium. Nothing to be alarmed about. You know, no one's going radioactive. Like I said, I drink it. But what I'm saying is that the ion exchange process would actually remove all the constituents that it has more of an affinity for. So that's a beautiful thing here. Really, really nice in terms of the results. So how does this work when you regenerate it? Well, the way that it works is, you know, your raw water comes in contact and you treat a certain amount of water. And then we take a salt saturator and we add service water to that to actually make saturated sodium chloride, and then we make a dilute sodium chloride solution from that. So we add that to the resin, and this is an actual regeneration. So on the bottom are all the bottles where we eluted chrome off of the resin in terms of chromate, and that's your concentrated waste that gets sent to disposal. So approximately for every, and I'll get to this in a later slide too, but I think I'll reiterate it because it's good to go slowly, you know, it's a lot of new information. Some of this is technical stuff. So to give you an idea, at the one well that we tested, we ran approximately, say, 40,000 bed volumes, which means basically a volume, you know, of this that is roughly, you know, 2 liters could treat 80,000 liters of water. So that gives you the relative scale of what it does. So 3 5-gallon pails could fill up a 2.5 million gallon swimming pool, Olympic-sized swimming pool, in terms of treated water. So that gives you kind of a relative basis for the amount of water you can pass through per volume of resin. And that's a concentrated product that you're getting out. So the stuff that looks like Gatorade is actually chromate. So that's what's in your water, but it's uber concentrated now over 40,000 passes. So up on the right-hand side is our actual pilot setup, and we had three identical columns operating in parallel. And if you were to just operate this as a single pass system, meaning whatever goes out of one column goes into your distribution system, you could run it roughly 36,000 bed volumes. However, there's still capacity on that resin, if you see the breakthrough curve, because it takes roughly 80 days to reach that point, but you reach the influent concentration at 110 days at roughly 48,000 bed volumes. So the next set of tests that we want to do is actually run what's called a lead lag. We want to run one column to complete exhaustion and have another column downstream. The lead column then gets regenerated, and then the lag column becomes the new lead column. And we want to see how much we can squeeze out of it. Okay? Make sense? Stop me if it doesn't. I expect questions, so stop me if something does not make sense. So we also looked at resin composition. And this is a big deal because a lot of people are looking at ion exchange. They're also looking at the technology behind it. So currently what we find is that the main percentage of constituent on the resin was sulfate prior to regeneration. Chloride was 21%, bicarbonate was 15%, nitrate was 7%, and chromate was 3%. So if you could get another percent out of here, it would make your resin, you know, if you can get 3% more chromate, it would make your resin actually last 33% longer. So the way that you actually manufacture your resin has a big is a big deal in terms of, you know, your spacing on the active sites on it, and I think that that's progressed. So there are new resins out there that would actually perform better than this one. So I heard a saying once that for water treatment plants, especially with a new technology, you want to be first in line to be like 20th in line.
Yeah.
So I think that a lot of plants that have been installed, although they work, it's always nice to see as technology advances. You know, my boss would always ask me at my old company, you know, why didn't you get it right the first time? And I said, look, if Apple has an iPhone 7 now, why didn't they get it right at the iPhone 1? There's a reason, right? You got to iterate to get to that point. So anyway, the changes get less and less over time. But this just gives you an idea that when you actually regenerate, it's not mostly, you know, chromate that's on your resin. It's actually a very small fraction. And if you can get that to be a little bit higher, that actually helps you tremendously in terms of efficiency. So you guys will notice that there was residual chloride left, which means that the total sites that were exchanged during regeneration were 79%. And there was some uranium found. So remember, uranium was the most, had the highest affinity for the resin. So that was mainly found in the top of the resin bed, meaning it wasn't able to migrate down. So that makes total sense for this. So the potential impacts of waste recycling is another thing that we're looking at. So, you know, we're actually generating this waste, and we're currently in a partnership with potentially several companies to look at ways of reducing the waste associated to this. So if you choose a membrane correctly, which is your NF membrane there, you can actually take your waste to disposal and decrease the volume. So you select a membrane of the right size. It actually allows sodium and chloride to pass through, which you can reuse, and it makes your chromium waste that much smaller of a volume. So to give you an idea, because the run times are so long, you know, you have so many bed volumes and you produce so little waste, this actually, if it cut it in half, is a tremendous reduction, you know, on an already, you know, tiny waste fraction. So, you know, we're also looking at potentially bleeding it back in. So this is all work that's ongoing at Reclamation now. There's also other stuff we have in the works. I have a meeting about a provisional patent this coming week. So we're also developing stuff. So a lot of people have been asking about, you know, stannous tin chloride. So it's an experimental process that was first tested about 10 years ago. And really it was kind of put on the shelf at that time because they said, hey, it got us 40% removal. It didn't do good enough. We can't do any more testing at the time, at this current time. So it's currently used as a food preservative, and it recently got NSF 61 certification, which means it can be used in water treatment processes. And what it does, it reduces, or in layman's terms, it converts your chrome 6, your chrome 8, to a chrome 3 form, which readily forms a solid. And this solid is then filtered out. So I'll pass this around. I can start up here. This would be a filter that you'd use. And this is the actual filter paper that's cut up from that filter. So you can pass it around, get a look.
Just a basic filter.
Just a basic filter. Something you could probably buy at the Home Depot. Right.
But in a full-scale plant, it'd be a larger filter.
Yeah, it'd be a larger filter than that. What it would look like would be either several canisters, or they make canisters that have several filter elements inside. So, in any case, the preliminary results have looked good. We are showing that the chrome 3 is filtered. We also are showing that some tin does pass through the system, so it's not filtered out. So what we believe is happening with the tin is stannous chloride is being oxidized to stannic, and then stannic is forming a solid, which we're not exactly sure what that is yet, but we have some ideas. And anyway, we know that some of it is removed on the filter also. So what we really want to do with the testing we're doing now is take the first step in the fundamental scientific understanding, and then take the next step to see, okay, now that we understand exactly what's happening, how is this actually applicable in a process? So in other words, do you change out these filters every week? Is it every day? Is it every 2 days? And then we'll look at composition and see, okay, now we're probably chrome 3. Is there a problem to just take this and throw it in the trash? Right? So we'll figure all those things out in terms of the fate of it, how long it lasts, and the economics associated to it. So currently now it does look promising, but I'll just stop it at that because I don't want to promise anything. I'm mainly a scientist, and if I find something out that's good or bad, I'll share it with you. So with that, I'll more or less leave it.
So the study that we're doing now in the district at well 16 and 15?
Correct.
Will take about 2 weeks for maybe a week or two.
Yeah.
And you want to speak a little bit about the process of water being in contact time with
right.
the stannous and then the various filters?
Right. So really what you're looking at, here I can actually show you the filter. So the two things you have to consider is when I add the stannous to the water, I know I'm going to form some kind of precipitate. We've seen it. However, does it take 30 seconds or does it take 5 minutes, right? It's a big difference because if we're talking about, say, a pump that delivers 400 gallons a minute, right? We're either talking about a 200-gallon storage to get this to react, or you're talking about, right, something much larger, you know, 2,000 gallons, right? So in terms of that, it's good to understand how long does it take to react. And then the second part of that would be I can pick filters in different sizes in terms of pore size. So you can't see the pore, but we're talking, you know, 20 micron, 5 micron, 50 micron, 1 micron. So if I have to filter everything with 1 micron, it might not make sense. You guys might be swapping filters every 6 minutes, right? That's not going to work. But if it's 20 micron, 25, 50, 5, whatever it might be, that's probably more doable. But we're testing all those to understand, okay, look, with this contact time, with this filter, that's a removal we saw. Okay? There's also another issue. So let's assume, you know, I take my chrome 6 measurement and my effluent, and it looks good, you know? I took it from 40 down to 3, and I'm like, man, I'm looking pretty. But also some chrome 3 passed through, maybe some tiny little particles or whatever it might be. Oh, it's Bill. That's the only time I'll decline his call, because I know he'll get upset. So, anyway, see if you can send him a text, because I know it's to do with the well house. So, in any case, understanding that if some chrome 3 does pass through, you know, the greatest invention ever, some people would argue, is the addition of chlorine to water, right? It kills things that make you sick, kills things that make, you know, kids die, elderly die, all these things, right? You're going to dose chlorine at some point after your filter. And what if your chrome 3 now can convert itself back, that's in contact with an oxidant, back to chrome 6? So it's something we're looking for also. We're trying to cover the full gamut. So make sure we removed all the chrome, right? Make sure that whatever's coming through doesn't reoxidize. So you have a process that, hey, at the plant looks great, man. We took a sample. You know, I'm going home, right? I'm going back to Boulder, see my kids, and I get a phone call. Hey, we failed everything, you know? Doesn't make sense, right? So we have to understand the full gamut. Make sense, Kurt?
Yep.
Excellent.
Simple, huh? Go ahead, ask him a question. Go ahead.
Yeah, you guys can ask questions.
Yeah. Any questions from the board? Is this a breaking point for questions? Seriously?
Yeah, you can ask questions, certainly.
Can we go back a few slides?
Yeah, absolutely.
To where you started to... There, that's good. What size are those that you're showing? Are those are filters we're looking at? What size would they
be? Oh, so the contactor there? For the physical ion exchange or for the nanofiltration?
For the whole things. What sizes are those?
Okay, so like a salt saturator here, typically what you'd size for would be, you know, I've designed plants that regenerated, just to give you an idea, up to once every 2 hours. Here you'd probably regenerate once every long time.
So how big is it?
So this would be fairly small. In terms of your salt saturator, you're probably talking about a system that, you know, could even come in like on a milk truck. Like, you know, you contract it out where someone drives up with a truck, regenerates it, and just takes the waste and hauls it. Like one pass. And there it would make a lot of sense to have the nanofiltration attached, because then they're hauling less waste as they generate it, they treat it, so on and so forth.
And it's a several-step process?
I wouldn't say it's a several-step process. So really what you're trying to do with the saturator, you'd have a tank, and the saturator for, you know, a system at one of these wells wouldn't be very big. It'd probably be something that you would load by hand. You'd literally get the salt in bags, dump it in to something bigger than a 55-gallon drum. But you're probably talking that size. Okay, make sense so far?
And where does it go? Where is the thing attached to? Or?
So the salt goes in to a saturator, and it fills up a little bit with water. Okay, that water is then pumped into another tank, either, and this can be different depending on the system. You could pump it into what's called a day tank, where you dilute it down to whatever concentration you need. So you don't want to put saturated salt, because it's kind of a waste of salt. You're going to dilute it down to something less. Okay. You can also dilute on the fly. In other words, if I have a conductivity probe, I can control two valves and say, okay, I'm pulling out of the saturator at this flow. I'm going to come in with this flow, and then my conductivity is going to tell me how much I need to add of each. And that'll be all programmed. So it's all relative. So either you have one tank where you blend on the fly, or you have two tanks, a day tank and a saturator.
I'm trying to remember back the big reservoir up there, the big tank on, was it Alta Loma? And we remember we went inside and we saw the different stuff that was working in there. Is that where this would go?
Well, we haven't decided yet, but right now we're thinking, and Miguel can correct me if it's changed, but this would be wellhead treatment, so all five wellheads.
Side. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. That was one of the questions I had.
Yeah. I had a question about the waste.
Yeah.
How often do you have to get rid of that? How much will there be, or would you anticipate?
So for that, say, 40,000 bed volumes, you're probably trucking away about a bed volume of waste. So, so to give you an idea, you know, for the Olympic-sized swimming pool, you would make 2.5 million gallons of water, and you'd truck away, you know, 15 gallons of waste.
Would that be very toxic, or would it be?
So, that is, depending on the well, it's going to be classified as something generally hazardous, right? Because you're concentrating up the chromium. Currently, it's actually being recycled. And it's actually being trucked down to a place that's accepting it, and they're using it for other processes.
Oh, okay.
So.
So they pay us for it?
I don't think you can pay you for it.
They'll take it for free. Yeah, just asking.
A lot of the cost is a freight associated to it. And I think the more creative that you get with certain things like this, you know, for instance, the nanofiltration, if you size the membrane right, you actually allow, because there will be some sodium chloride that's left over that would just go to waste, right? You'd send it in the truck, it would go away. But sodium chloride can be used for your next regeneration. So if you can get a good separation between all the nasty things in your water and your sodium chloride, you can actually reuse that. So that's the intent of this. So say take your waste down by 60%, and reuse 50% of that, something like that. So, yeah.
And the waste disposal with anion exchange is a large portion of the cost for operation?
Yes, definitely the large portion of the cost.
And so this is for anion exchange, not stannous chloride.
Right.
And the waste stream from stannous chloride is probably just the filters.
Right.
So that's really different.
Which don't have to be hauled to LA.
It's very different. That's right. Yeah. You're probably talking about something you can just put in the trash.
Wow.
Yep. Look forward to hearing how this continues and what you find. Yeah.
A lot of people are, trust me. I'm getting more and more phone calls every day.
Especially that dot in Oklahoma.
Yeah. Oh, they're super excited.
Yeah.
You know? Wow. So it's good. You know, you come to places and in general, people are interested in their water, and it's gratifying on my end, right? So I couldn't imagine working a better job. So it's good.
Do we have any questions from the audience?
Learning a lot right now.
Yeah. Just saying. Yeah.
Cool.
Right. Maybe the question about why wouldn't we? And I'm setting you up because I really know the answer to this. Why wouldn't we simply choose stannous chloride if the whole, you know, waste stream is so much less? And, you know, so tell us about that.
So at least in my mind, you want to see something go through all the testing. And in general, what you want to see is you want to see a larger scale demonstration. So the nice thing about it, I know down the road, Coachella Valley, I'm actually on their technical advisory committee. So I'm going to be seeing live time what happens there, and we're going to share what happens here.
Excellent.
So my hope is that at some point a pilot of that size would come here. So we're not just testing something smaller scale, where we're actually verifying with more of a demonstration scale for what would be, you know, the treatment. And maybe move that around to all the wells, whatever it might be. So I think that's really how to see it, you know. You know, like I said before, and I know it sounds funny, but, you know, the richest company in the world didn't get it right for 7 times. I mean, there's something there, right? It's not just me up here fabricating stuff. I mean, it's really how the thing works. As an engineer, a lot of people look to you and say, but you got to have the answer. And we try our best, we really do. But you really, if when you iterate on it, it's truly the best design.
Excellent. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Miguel. You're taking off tomorrow about noon, are you?
Yeah.
Okay. We'll talk by phone. I don't have. I use one of these phones. Not yet. But thank you very much, and thank you for your team. I'm assuming that Bill was out at the well.
Yes.
So does that mean that Julie's also out at the well?
Yeah, I think I'll head over there.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you need to leave, please feel free.
And I was going to say that you probably want to need to leave, because the next one is going to be a quarterly financial report.
Oh, yeah.
I have to manage them, so I'll do that on my own time.
Miguel, thank you so much.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks a lot.
We'll be back.
Yeah.
Bye-bye. All right, we are moving on to item number 10. First quarter ending September 2016 stamp report. Susan?
Yes. Cue the report. Not quite as technical as his, but equally as baffling perhaps to some. Okay. So this is for our first quarter of this fiscal year, so the quarter ending 9/30/16. I don't know how to advance.
You can just click the button.
Which button?
Wrong button.
Normal left.
Okay, there we go. So the summary, the big picture, and then we get down into more of the detail here. Our cash flow report will show us that we collected nearly almost $1 million in water utility payments from customers. Keep in mind that this would be the highest quarter of the year as far as bills are concerned. Our highest, the largest water usage occurs typically in the month of August, sometimes July, sometimes September, but either of those would be included in this total, so that's really expected. We collected $85,000 in property taxes and assessments, $79,000 we got from High Desert Medical Center for operating their wastewater treatment plant, $26,000 grant funding came from MWA, actually related to this very project, the Chromium 6 study. We got $101,000 in development impact fees, $44,000 was spent on our capital projects, $174,000 we paid our Copper Mount Mesa Assessment District debt, and our cash increased about $98,000 during the quarter. Cash balances, capital spending is minimal, and that really increases our cash balances because we fund for those expenditures. Both our emergency and our opportunity funds are at their target balances, and they have been for more than a year, quite some time. Total cash increased again, $98,000 over the last quarter and almost $400,000 over a year ago. Property taxes and assessments, we don't bill the property taxes into the financial records until the second quarter, so there are no revenues yet recorded. And the monies that we received are a cleanup check that comes every year from the county after the fiscal year end, but this really relates to last year. So we got about $85,000 from them, which is related to last year's collections. Or assessments. The board report, total revenues are at 21% of budget, and that excludes those property tax revenues that I just talked about. Those are a really big portion of our overall revenues, though 33% in the current budget, so nearly a third of our revenues are generated from our property taxes. Water revenues are at 32% of budget, and remember back to what I said, we should be ahead of our 25%. First, you know, typically your first quarter is 25%. We should be ahead of it because our highest consumption comes in this first quarter, and we are. Total expenses are 17% of budget, and revenues exceed expenses by $232,000. Consumption statistics, usage for the 12 months is 1% more than last year and 11% less than 2 years ago. That this is not the same correlation as to the water conservation mandate. This is usage for 12 months ending, and that was something entirely different. So the top 10 users, always the same basically. You know, hospital, our multi-unit housing, public agencies, and our commercial accounts. So getting down into more detail on the cash flow, the beginning balance, almost $8.2 million. Revenues, $1.3 million during the quarter in total. Again, the water bill payments, almost $1 million. Grant revenue, that $25,000 from Mojave.
our property taxes there, our High Desert Medical Center, it shows you there the breakdown, the reimbursement of actual costs incurred, these are their expenses, $64,000, and then they pay us $14,000 over a three-month period to do the work for them, to manage all of this on their behalf. We sold 3 new meters in the month, plus we collected the High Desert Medical Center capacity fee. Remember, they have amortized that over 15 years and pay us, it's around $75,000 each year. And we got a little bit of interest revenue, $11,000. Then to the expense side, how we use the money that we got, $1.2 million we spent on all, for all purposes. Again, we paid that Copper Mountain debt service, which that is money that those folks pay on their property taxes. We simply pass through to the bondholder. Capital costs, $44,000 roughly. Chromium 6 study was a big part of that. Well 14 rehab and then some computer and monitor costs. We remember the board authorized replacement of all the computers and monitors. Other, you know, use of funds is pretty typical. We ended the quarter with $8.3 million and cash increased by $98,000. Cash balances, current year to, we compare the current quarter to the last quarter to a year ago, okay? So current quarter ending in 8.3, last quarter 8.2, really very little differences there. We did, however, fund all of our reserve funds. Our equipment and technology reserve fund is increased by about $108,000 over last quarter. We fund them at the beginning of the year. We have a well and booster reserve, also a little over $100,000 goes into that fund each year. And our building reserve fund, $26,000 goes into that fund. So these are those reserves that we fund intentionally for a replacement of known expenses, things that we know are going to come up. We just replaced all of our computers with this equipment and technology reserve fund. So we didn't have to find that source of money. We had that money in reserve already. Here again is our emergency fund, $1 million, our opportunity fund, $2 million, and we've had that money since, you know, for more than a year. We've been back up to our limit. And here we were a year ago, $7.9 million, and now $8.3 million. Next, this is a little bit more detail about that 9/30/16. We have restricted funds. Per the district, we have legally restricted funds, which the law says are restricted, and then we have all of our unrestricted funds. So the district's restricted funds, things like all of those reserve funds I just talked about, the district restricts those. The law does not, okay? Legally restricted funds, our Copper Mountain Mesa Assessment District is the best example of that. Those folks pay us for that debt service, and we're not allowed to spend that on other things. We have to restrict it for that. Our customer deposits are legally restricted for a specific purpose, and then everything else is unrestricted. So in total, this number increased $390,000 over the last year, and then you can see what happened, you know, through each of those individual accounts. Property taxes, you know, not much to talk about here because we haven't billed our current year taxes yet. We received a little bit of money here from the tax collector, and here's what we received last year in the same type of cleanup check. It's almost identical. We haven't billed our current year, any of our assessments or taxes yet, and so that'll be in our next quarter. We've done that by now, but it's not in our first quarter. So our board report, the revenue side, total revenues, 21% of budget, water revenues, 32%, pretty much where, you know, where we need to be. High Desert Medical Center, we bill in arrears, so our first quarter billing will come in the second quarter for High Desert Medical Center. And then here, $1.8 million is what our budget is this year for all of our property taxes, and those have not been recorded yet, so they are not in this number yet. So, and then grant revenues, we're already at 90% because we've received most of the money, or we've recorded, I guess I should say, most of the reimbursement for the Chromium 6 testing already. The expense side, you can see all the figures here where we're tracking in the various departments, production, distribution, et cetera. Pretty much everybody at or where they need to be. You notice bonds and loans at 38%. That's tracking ahead of where you would expect it to be now at 25%. But we've made the principal payment and the first interest payment for the Copper Mount Mesa Assessment District. And bonds and loans is specifically one of those departments that does not track according to 25, 50, 75, and 100%. Those, you know, costs come in and in very large increments, staggered throughout the year, not, you know, in a month by month or quarter basis. High Desert Medical Center, same thing. We're you know, we're very early into the year for them. We probably didn't have necessarily all of the costs yet for each of the months. So overall, expenses are at 17%. This is actually identical to where we were last year as of 9/30, 17%. So, interesting. Consumption statistics, here again, it shows you sort of how many hundred, you know, cubic feet. This is units, 519,000 units is what we sold for the 12 months ending 9/30/2016. So compare that to the 5 or 10 units you use at your own house. That's the gallons represented there, the number of acre feet. So we have an increase of 0.99% over last year, so 1% increase compared to last year, and then a almost 12% increase from the prior year, and over the 3-year period, 11% decrease. So this is the change between 2014 and 16, 11% decrease. But again, this does not correlate to that conservation mandate, which had a rolling period and compared to, I don't know what, so too complicated. I don't want to think about that. So this really relates to water sales, okay, and you know how much water we sell. And that's the important piece here. So our top 10 ranking, the, you know, our software gives us this information every month. Actually, the there are several agencies that request this kind of information, your top 10 users, kind of interestingly. And by category, you know, we've got the hospital and the continuing care. They are typically our number one user almost every single quarter. Interestingly, public agencies pulled ahead this time because of Joshua Tree Parks and Recreation. This is the time when they're doing their water program out at the park, and I'm assuming that's what it relates to. So this is summer, peak of summer, this quarter, okay? So they pulled, you know, far ahead of anybody else. Then, you know, multi-unit housing, mobile home parks and apartments, et cetera. So our top 10 users. Then I want to talk a little bit, lastly, comparing our budget and our actual water revenues. A very important issue, and really this, you know, I started last year because of the whole conservation issue and how, you know, we know that conservation is the mandate, but less, you know, more conservation means water revenues are down. So I started looking at both our budget, 16, 17, 15, 16, and our actual. So how are we tracking, you know, what we thought we would get versus, you know, where we are for all of our water categories. Basic fees, and this includes our locked meter accounts now, metered water sales, which is that consumption amount, and then some other miscellaneous fire protection and special services charges. So you can see our current year budget is $1.7 million. Last year, $1.4 million roughly. Remember, we reduced last year's budget by hundreds of thousands of dollars because of the conservation mandate. We knew that we would not generate that much money. So our budget this year is 23% higher than last year's budget. Rates went up as well, and you know, we can't deny that. But we took more than a $220,000 reduction to revenue last year because of conservation. Now this year, we're at $426,000 we have generated in revenue, what we've billed so far as of 9/30. Last year, that number was $348,000, so there's that conservation issue. We know conservation, unfortunately, is down this year. It's, you know, we're not doing the same numbers as we saw last year, and we can see it in the revenue. This is actually... That's not true. This is not conservation. This is all related to the locked meters.
$300,000. $290-some thousand is the increased expected revenue for this year. Metered water sales is consumption. Okay. Last year, 1.67 million, 1.6, the budget, a 5% increase this year, and then you can see what happened, you know, 40% increase in billed water consumption this year compared to last year. So water usage is way up. Okay. So miscellaneous, fire protection, special services, you can see just some minor changes there. So overall, our current budget for water revenues, $3.5 million. Last year was $3.1. That's a 12% increase. The actual, how are we tracking? What have we billed? $1.1 million versus $852,000. That's a 31% increase in water revenues. Driven, one, by the locked meter charges, and two, by the increased consumption. So the 15-16 figures... were significantly reduced because of that conservation mandate. We knew that. We adjusted at the beginning, but we adjusted again mid-year because we weren't even tracking to that point. And then the 16-17 charges are substantially increased because of those locked meter charges. Okay. That's the end. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer.
You're welcome. Any questions from the board?
That was much better than the NI and exchange.
Thank you. Oh, I'm so excited to hear that.
I could follow this.
Do you have any questions? Okay. Any questions from the board?
I got a quick one.
Certainly.
It looked like the Memorial Park was up there twice in the top 10.
They have 2 meters.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes.
Any questions from the room?
Yeah.
Go to the, please, so that he can get you on tape. Thank you.
El Marquez, Sun Bear Community. Could you tell us how many units were produced from the wells and how many units were sold by these wells?
We can get you that information. I don't think we have the actual well production.
The reason why
we don't have the production, here's what the sales is. This is the number of units.
The reason why I'm asking the question is how many gallons of water were lost through broken pipes and stuff like that. That's the reason I asked the question.
Okay. I'm sorry, this is not the representative. This is for the 12 months, so that's not what was sold over 3 months. So.
Any other questions? Seeing none, Susan, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Yeah, excellent.
You're welcome.
Yeah, very good. Standing committee reports. Finance committee.
Well, Susan just presented.
We just saw.
We discussed at our finance committee meeting.
I was there.
And did an excellent job of that. It was a better opportunity then, or an easier opportunity to discuss all the different issues.
Detailed,
well put together. Thank you.
And their next meeting is February 27th.
And I might add that there was standing room only, and we
come early. Yes,
yes. Right. Come early, or there won't be seats.
Did you meet in a closet?
Okay. Water resources and operations. That was actually a really excellent meeting. We're talking about needs for the building, and I thought it was very interesting. Anything you want to add to that?
No. Frankly, I don't even recall what we talked about because there's been so much other stuff since then.
Yeah, you've got so much going on. The next meeting is the same as the finance. We meet right after them at 10 a.m. on February 27th. And the last standing committee is legislative and public information. Kathleen, give that report.
Yes, we had a great meeting this morning, and the next one is at 9:30 a.m. March 1st, since those people I talked to today didn't even know it was happening. But we do cover a lot, and on the list of items that we shared this morning was that the district tour dates have been locked in for this round, which the tours are via grants from Mojave Water Agency. There will be water in the aquifer at time, March 30th, is the first date, April 6th the second date, both of those are Thursdays, and April 25th is a Tuesday. So we have three dates set for the tours, of which time we anticipate seeing a lake out there, which is always kind of neat. Then, Water Education Day is coming together very well. We already have 27 confirmed exhibits with 7 pending, which means we'll have a lot more than last year, and a lot of the exhibits coming back are expanding the topics they're teaching on, which is very good. There's so much to teach on. So that, in case you haven't marked it down, it is March 26th from 1 to 4. I will have the official flyers available at the next board meeting, of which I will cover all the neat new stuff. There's new things coming in, too. Lastly, the customer service portion of our website, kind of been working through some things on it, but we came across in the archives of our cloud a really cool graphic explaining our bill cycle. And it's so visual and so simple, so anyone that's trying to figure out when we put our bills out and when we charge a late fee and when the lock-offs are, this very simple graphic explains the whole thing, and it's on the website under customer service documents and reports. I encourage anyone that's confused to go look at it. It's very clear. And while you're there, check out the whole website. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Kathleen. Moving on to item number 12, District General Counsel Report.
Gil. I have nothing for the open session, Madam Chairman.
Thank you. Item number 13, General Manager's Report.
Okay, let's see here. It's just a few things. So, NextEra, there's no further action on the part of NextEra. However, we did receive another public information request asking for information on installation of meters from the Coalition for Responsible Solar, and the documents are being reviewed by Gil's firm, and we'll be responding to that. Let me just jump down here to Dollar General. We have received a request from Dollar General on January 18th requesting a renewal of their will serve letter. We never issued them a will serve letter. We've issued them yes, you're in the water
W1
service area, and yes, you're in the wastewater treatment area. So we've informed them that they need to, it was from an engineering firm. So we informed them that they would need to provide us some sort of proof from Dollar General that they actually were representing Dollar General, and that they would have to send us a deposit, I forget what amount that was, $5,000? A $5,000 deposit before we do any further analysis, and DUDEC will be looking at their plans, which they're going to have to submit along that same way. And so I wanted to skip to Dollar General after mentioning the request for public information from Coalition for Responsible Solar, so that if anybody's watching on YouTube, Mr. Fick, instead of sending the district a request for public information, maybe somebody could just call us and we'll get you the information on Dollar General, because it's less expensive. Okay. So the county mental health facility. The county's working with DUDEC Engineering on details of the septic system and pipe replacement. Let's bring up the hydro pneumatic and see if Kurt can.
Yeah,
works
great.
Whoop-de-doo thing. Okay, so there's a hydro pneumatic station that services the K zone. So where's that? Well, this is Onaga. South of Alta Loma, you go up, I think this is Olympic, and then you turn on Onaga, and then you come up whatever street this is. And here's our facility. So this...
You want to go to the right, turn to the right.
Right.
Yeah.
Where the little...
Over here.
Asterisk is.
Okay. So this area, right, is the K-zone. It's about 40 houses. The water goes from the wells, the C tank, to the D tank, to the G tank. Wait a minute, I got that wrong.
D, F,
H, J, and then from the J tank, way over like about maybe a half mile away from La Contenta, flows all the way back over to this hydropneumatic station. And it's not a reservoir, it's a tank that three pumps, two pumps and a standby fire pump, which I'll get to in a minute, pumps out of the distribution system into this tank, and then there's an air compressor, and there's a balance between the amount of water that's in there and the amount of air pressure that's in there, and it's then distributed to the various residences in the area. So on January 26th at 11 a.m., field crew responded to an electric panel failure. There we go. See that little panel right there, or that electrical box? That's a Southern California Edison electric box. Okay. So there was a fire in that box, and it shut stuff down. So the two pumps and motors on the left-hand side, which we'll get to in a bit, are what are powered by that electrical panel and all the other panels that were designed in 1995. Okay, so I'm going to go, if I can get this to work, go back over to this panel and open it up for you, I think. There we go. So, when the crew responded, they had to cut, the fire was out, they had to cut the Southern California Edison cable lock, which is not that big a deal. And they looked inside, and these bus bars are designed, for the layperson, for me, they're basically a fuse, circuit breaker, whatever. Mm-hmm. But there was so much warming, cooling, and resistance that this particular breaker bar actually burned and shut down. Okay. So the crew called Southern California Edison, said, we need you to come up here and look at your box. And in the meantime, we took one of our smaller emergency generators and went up to the site and hooked it into the system. And within 2 hours, we had power back to the site, and none of the customers lost any water service. So Southern California Edison came out by 7 p.m. They were quite cooperative, and they used their little bucket truck and went up on the poles and pulled their fuses for safety, and then identified that the issue was on our side of the meter. So interesting that these bus bars are past the meter, but they're inside the Southern California Edison electric lock box. So they pulled the fuses. Mm. We then got a hold of
CNS Electric,
who luckily had some of the needed equipment on their shelf. And they came out on January 27th by 2 p.m., put that back together. And then Southern California returned at 11 p.m. And put the fuses back online. So the system was in full operation some 18 hours after it occurred. So I know that the board wants to see more activities of what's going on in the field. Go back to the start of the program for me, William.
Which one?
Oh, let me run through here. Right. I thought I had a picture. This was Kurt's photography skills. So I thought there was a picture of the three pumps that Bill took the next day. There we go. Cool. All right. So the two pumps on the left are 150 gallon per minute pump motors, right? And one of them pumps, and if it shuts down or if there's a greater demand, the second one can kick on. If you notice when we walked over that pump and motor haven't been operational for a period of time. So I asked crew what's going on and said, well, we're sort of nursing this one along and we're trying to get it to work. And if this fails after a significant drop in pump pressure, this fire pump will kick on. Well, the way this was designed was these were supposed to be the redundant ones. So Randy called who'd you call?
I called Multi-W Systems, Chief Engineer Wen Wang, which is the individuals that are quoting some replacement pumps at this time, just to get an idea of what type of life cycle we can expect from these type of pumps. He said the best scenario, 15 to 20 years, and worst scenario would be 3 to 5 years. He gave a fantastic example, which I think everyone can relate to. Everyone drives a car, and we all know that when you stop and go very frequently, it puts a lot of wear and tear on your vehicle. And that is the worst case scenario. And so in this instance, this hydropneumatic pressure station, there's a lot of stopping and going that's occurring. So in the worst case scenario, 3 to 5 years, that this is kind of the element that we should expect from this site. I would point out, after talking to our production supervisor, that we've had 22 years of the site being online. So it has done fantastically for us. But that's the life cycle projections that we've been given.
So we're in the process of getting bids to replace all three pumps. And certainly one needs to be replaced because there's no redundancy for the system in the way it was designed in 1995. And if the life cycle is, in best case scenario, is 15 to 20 years, we're in year 22. And it's just part of the deferred maintenance. And it just so happens that in our capital improvement plan,
yes, so in our capital improvement plan for this hydropneumatic station, we have prioritization in the capital improvement plan. It looks at four different criteria: useful life, condition assessment, operational assessment, as well as failure consequence. When we looked at that compared to all of our other production sites, this was in the top five. And it was slated to be replaced, if we're following track with our capital improvement plan, by the 2019-2020 fiscal year. So, I mean, it really solidifies this plan in terms of you know, the urgency of replacement, and that's what we're seeing here.
So we're going to replace those pumps and be about $2,500 per pump and motor, and that'll be $7,500 less that we need in the capital improvement plan.
We have a reserve, well and booster reserve.
And we have a well and booster reserve, which it will come out of. Yep. So anyway, that was just another day for the production department and Southern California Edison. So let's see, the BLM lease, you remember they had increased our lease from $9,000 to $40,000 last year, this is 17, so 16, so 15, went from 9,000 to 40,000 in 16. And we've been working with them, and they've reduced the number of acres that we're on using of BLM land. And so this year's lease, instead of 40,000, is 15,000.
No kidding.
But,
congratulations.
But there's no guarantee that 5 years from now, that won't go up, and 5 years after that it won't go up. So we're still on the list of things to do to come up with a better response to the BLM lease situation, and Bighorn is also working the issue. I mentioned earlier that our grant and loan from SWRCB had been received. It's been approved and sent back to us on January 18th. And we had a conference call today with Susan, Randy, and I talking to the Division of Finance Program Manager, going over all of the reporting procedures and requirements and changes to the compliance plan and getting to a point of construction. We're going to be able to handle all that stuff, but it's another example of grants aren't free. The amount of reporting that staff will have to do, it comes with grants and loans. And what's a single audit?
Yeah.
So what kind of, I guess we do a married audit?
Well, actually, we don't meet the single audit threshold because our grant is only $500,000.
Okay.
And a single audit, which is a higher level audit, which costs more, of course, is required if you get more than $750,000 in a single year, in a fiscal year, from the federal government, not a factor if it's from the state. And apparently we found out that these particular planning funds flow from the federal government to the state, so they are federal funds.
So, we're on it. No, that's not it. So, I was reading the weekend High Desert Star Basin-wide Weekend Edition, and on the front page there's a little article about what it costs to get a well online at 29 Palms. And their well 11 was taken out of service because its water has more chromium 6 than state regulations allow, and also because the well's metal casing has also deteriorated too badly to be used. So they were talking about putting that well back online. And the newspaper article projected costs for this 500-foot deep well to be $573,000. And the treatment of the water would cost $665,000, the anion exchange treatment plant. I called Ray. I said, Ray, what's going on? Because our estimates to treat anion exchange at our wells are twice to three times higher than that. Well, it turns out that this is a 400 gallon per minute well, and their chromium 6 levels are just slightly above the parts per billion MCL. So rather than a 400 GPM well, we've got 1,000, 1,300, and 2,000 gallon per minute wells that are not 500 feet deep. They're down to 740 feet deep. And if you're close to the MCL, you don't have to treat all your water. You can treat some of it and then blend it back in with the other water. So if there was anybody that was reading this article, I thought it would be important to point out that these are the numbers for that well with that condition of parts per billion of chromium 6, et cetera. So, and then, let's see, we're going to begin taking recharge water on March 15th. We're taking 584 acre feet of which will be, because we've received payment from NextEra to resupply the aquifer for the project. And the way that the water supply agreement is written, whether they do the project or not anytime in the next 40 years, they don't get that money back. So we're putting the water in the ground. And at some time in the future, if they or somebody else puts in a solar project, the water will already be there. And we are advertising for construction and maintenance one and or construction and maintenance two worker to replace a vacancy that's occurred in distribution. The vacancy closes on February 28th. It'll be advertised in the papers. It's on
the website,
and it's on Brown and
BC Water Jobs.
So if you know of anybody with a strong work ethic of looking for an entry-level position into the water industry, they might want to go to our website and apply. And they might want to go to the 29 Palms website and look there, because they're hiring two positions. And we've sent the accounts receivable job description to the union for comment. They have until this Friday, and then we'll be bringing the job description to the board on February 15th. For approval, it's already been run through the Water and Resources Operations Committee. And that's the end of my report, I think.
Thank you very much. Any questions for the general manager? Seeing none, we will move on to the next item, future director meetings and training opportunities. The Mojave Water Agency Board of Directors meeting is February 9th, and that will be Vice President Johnson. The ASB-CSD, that's the Association of San Bernardino County Special Districts Dinner, is coming up on February 27th. We're going to be kind of round-robining that. I don't know where it will be, but we'll determine who will go to that. And it's not on here, but the Technical Advisory Committee of Mojave Water Agency is meeting tomorrow morning, and I will be going to that. Are you going to go to that? Yeah, Kurt and I will both be going to that. So those are the future meetings. And we will do director's reports on meetings attended and your comments and future agenda items. Start with Victoria this time.
Okay, I attended the Finance Committee meeting. I've already given a report on that, so that's all I have for this week.
I don't want to shock you, but I don't have any comments.
We're going to get out of here early.
Same thing with the Finance Committee. That was another fantastic meeting, thanks to the staff. I do encourage the public to come. It's a good way to check and see how we're spending the money and see where our financial budgets and everything are headed. Also at the Water Resources and Operations Committee meeting, which is a pretty stimulating meeting in terms of all the projects that are going on. So if you're interested, please come. And we'll be at Mojave on the 9th.
Good.
And I went to Mojave last week, and Bob, you'll like this. On February 9th, they're going to adopt the new water rates. Their CFO, Kathy Kortner, she recommended a slight raise for Improvement District M, which is the Morongo Basin pipeline, from $52 acre foot to $54 at the coming from the Johnson Valley Pumping Station. And she says, you know, of course, other costs go into this, mostly the power to pump, and the real rate would be more like $569 an acre feet. So they're going to talk about that when you go next week. They had a mid-year budget review. General Manager Kirby Brill explained that these discussions will be ongoing for the coming months. So you'll probably have fun with that one, too. Kathy Kortner said the original budget for revenues was $68 million, but now anticipates $69 million budget due to a small increase in one-time water sales, slightly lower Department of Water Resources costs, but she noted that the reserves have only grown by $4 million. And those were information items, you know, input for the board. There was a to vote on was the state water project allocations, and the board voted 7-0 to approve the staff recommendations as follows: Joshua Basin, 584 acre feet; High Desert, 3,200 acre feet; Bighorn, 70 acre feet. And they had talked about the state water project allocations could go as high as their 60% due to that wet and snowy winter, but that Mojave's going to base its allocations to contractors like us at 45%. They've been storing over 12,000, almost 13,000 acre feet in the San Luis Reservoir, and that's out in Merced County, and that gets the water from the Delta. They had added two items to the agenda, one in open session, one in closed. The open session item was approved 7-0 for $33,000 to hire Roberts Consulting Group of Rancho Mirage recruit replacements for retiring GM Kirby Brill. The ad hoc committee consisted of directors of Beverly Lowry, Jim Ventura, and Vice President Mike Page. Lowry stated that the consultants brought them Kirby Brill several years ago, and that's the best reference, she said. Ventura added that the process will take 12 to 13 weeks, and that the consultants will take input from the board, the staff, and the employees. And I had to say, they have a new director on the board, a real newbie, Smitty.
Yeah. Smitty.
Good guy. But I sympathize with him all the way, because he was asking questions, and his head was just swimming, and he, you know, was starting it. And a lot of this stuff, extremely complicated. A lot of really, you would have loved this, Gary, a lot of really interesting and technical, hydrological, geological conversations around all these things. Really interesting.
You might have loved that.
Yeah, it really was good. And I took a lot of notes. I didn't put them in, but I sure sympathize with old Smitty up there. He's really getting it. And then I went on Saturday to the Mongo Basin Conservation Association's annual meeting, and they had What About My Water Forum. And Kurt was in that, Marina from Bighorn, Tony Culver from High Desert, and Matt Schrag from 29 Palms. It was a question and answer forum, as well as, you know, explaining what each of our districts do, what we're working on, what are our challenges. It was really interesting. And kind of having studied water for the past several years, you learn something new every time. It was absolutely fascinating. Really, really a great forum. And thank you, Kurt. That was great. And that's what I have.
Excellent. All right. We're going to now adjourn to closed session for the closed session item number 8 that was moved down. So do I have a motion to...
Madam Chair, may I read something into the record that I'm required to read into a matter such as this? It's characterized as a pre-closed session comment. I've done this before, and it's mandated by the Brown Act on this particular type of matter. So for the record, I'll read slowly for Beverly. The record should reflect that it is required by Government Code Section 54956.9, (E)(2). The record should reflect that at this time, the board will go into closed session pursuant to Government Code Section 54956.9 to consult with legal counsel and the district's general manager on a matter of potential litigation. One matter concerning the receipt of correspondence from Lane Christensen Company notifying the district, Joshua Basin Water District, of its intention not to provide any further disinfection work on Well 14 on the purported basis of impossibility and or impracticality and other factors. End of open session statement.
Thank you.
If the public would like to know, this is probably going to, my eye's off, but I'll take a guess. It's about 2 or 3 Super Bowl commercials, I'd say about 15 minutes.
Okay, so we're adjourned to closed session. There will be basically no reportable action, and we'll be back, and I'll make a motion that we adjourn to closed session.